Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it is a great pleasure for me to meet with you all here today. I'd like to start by thanking Mrs. Irene Khan, Director General of the International Development Law Organization, for inviting me to this conference. I want to acknowledge the presence of the distinguished participants who, since yesterday, brought to the Assembly important insights on the issue of sustaining peace, sustainable development, and the contribution of the rule of law. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm here representing a group of fragile in or post-conflict countries, with the expectation that this forum can really explore the challenges and the opportunities faced by international and national actors to build peace and advance development. This global commitment conveys the needs and aspirations of humankind in a broad and true manner in order to ensure that people are at the center of our actions, both in developed as well as developing countries. I believe everyone here is familiar with the lessons we have learned from the past, including from the implementation of the Millennium Development Goals. Indeed, the new agenda states that by 2030, no one should be left behind. Promoting the rule of law and ensuring equal access to justice for all in fragile and conflict-affected states are extremely complex tasks that are often poorly understood by international assistance. The justice sector is unequivocally a key sector for development. A fragile sector of justice may jeopardize the very state, as well as the economic and social development of the nation. While it is important that we provide the institutions of justice the appropriate and necessary support, we have to agree that this is an issue that must be addressed with the urgency and the seriousness that the human and the humanitarian demands of justice requires from us, lest we risk a justice system that is inflexible or even without intention, one that neglects respect for the rights and the guarantees of victims and witnesses, as well as, importantly, the accused. Although Timor-Leste has relied on international assistance for these past 15 years, or maybe because of the way in which this international assistance was led, we must now invest more so that we may have an efficient justice system where cases are processed in a prompt, balanced, independent, and efficient manner. A true reform of the justice sector is still to be undertaken in Timor-Leste. This task will surely take years in view of its complexity and starting point, position. I believe that this reform is very important. Indeed, while acknowledging the meritorious effort made by the Timorese magistracy to improve its operation, the fact is that there is a long way ahead of us in order to prevent perceptions of injustice which might undermine the very rule of law and the trust of citizens and investors. International cooperation through a process that is responsible, human, and inclusive, and owned by national decision makers, will surely be part of the solution to this challenge. Ladies and gentlemen, it should be noted that the process for setting the ambitious 17 Sustainable Development Goals included inputs from fragile and conflict-affected states. This has allowed a more considered and effective approach to the various aspects of sustainable development and its challenges at the global level, as well as to the vital role that peace and stability play in achieving this development vision. The G7 Plus and the New Deal, which have been advocating the need for adopting proper peace-building and state-building processes, have enabled more collaborative actions to create a new development paradigm, as well as new forms of engagement in fragile and conflict-affected states. The difficulties experienced in these countries, which often include widespread and extreme poverty, requires cautious international intervention in which all parties are both students and teachers, as we know that all situations and contexts are unique and therefore do not allow for a one-size-fits-all approach. We, the members of the G7 Plus group, are aware that our countries present very particular development challenges. As such, we have assumed the political commitment to adopt the 2030 Agenda, in which we advocate the inclusion of Goal 16, peace, justice, and strong institutions, since we know that without peace, justice, and sound and efficient institutions, it would be very hard for us to implement any of other 16 SDGs. We must acknowledge that our agenda will fail to achieve its goals if it does not start by improving the living conditions of the people in countries plagued by wars and conflict, particularly, as we expect, extreme poverty in 2030 to be concentrated in those countries. Giving back hope to men, women, and children who have been left behind in the progress of humanity is more than a moral duty. It is also a global responsibility and a matter of justice. Poverty and conflict are man-made. As such, I believe they can be stopped by all of us who share the values of freedom and human dignity. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, most of these conflicts have been going on for decades. The causes of most of them are well known. Most make us question ourselves about the values of humanity and civilization in a world that is supposed to be developed and technologically advanced. Today, we are so globally interconnected that an event in one part of the world may soon affect the lives of common citizens, institutions, and states in any other part of the world. The physical distance separating local from global events is often minimized by technology. Because of this, the wealth of a few clashes shamefully with the extreme poverty of many, leading to generalized feelings of revolt and intolerance. We cannot remain indifferent to the tragedy faced by some of the peoples of the world unless human solidarity is on the wane and we all are becoming inured to the suffering of others. Such problems are the responsibility of us all, even If some of us are mired in our own internal problems, we cannot interfere in international matters only when we have national interests and strategies to defend. Ultimately, peace depends on every one of us through small decisions, actions, and initiatives that we can make and adopt in order to change the world. It is urgent that we understand that peace inside each of us depends upon peace between all of us, regardless of ethnicity, religion, ideology, or culture. We must work together as a community in order to find solutions to our common problems and to prevent tragedies and suffering now as well as in the future. We have endured two world wars and a period of Cold War. If we can learn something from our recent history and from the tragic consequences of this conflict, it is that we cannot put an end to war by waging war. We cannot stop violence with further violence. We cannot wash off blood with blood. We cannot repeat the errors of the past. We must face the causes of the problems, read the signs, and anticipate and foresee the future. Everyone should refuse to accept that one can talk about war, and we can see this on TV almost every day, from a perspective of defense or attack, while mechanisms of dialogue and diplomacy are still available to us, which might build tolerance and trust between countries, which might build peace. We already know the results of intervention that use force. They end up leading to even bloodier conflicts. We can see this in the Middle East, in Africa. We see tensions continue to rise until they even become nuclear threats. We witness ethnic rivalries, religious rivalries, and various types of extremism. We witness an increasing number of acts of terrorism, an increase in the number of refugees. A few days ago, not a few, they again in the coast of Libya, who, instead of being celebrated for their sacrifice and for the courage they display in surviving, are instead shunned. And still, we continue to be unable to find proper international solutions to problems that plague humankind. We are living in a world disorder that requires the rebuilding of the international system, a system that establishes long-term partnership between countries without hitting agendas and without taking advantages of the small and weak, just to defend their business and profits, but towards common goals of development and human dignity as the foundation for stability. The key questions in today's world are knowing how much longer major powers will continue promoting and funding wars and conflicts, and how much longer international organizations will continue to react to problems instead of trying to prevent them. Ladies and gentlemen, the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development was unanimously approved by the 193 UN member states. Are these world leaders truly committed to goals seeking to make the world a better place? I'm speaking of fragile and conflict-affected states, which, by advocating the inclusion of the promotion of peace in this global agenda, have the moral obligation to do all they can so that their various institutions can manage development assistance effectively and transparently, and so that wealth is distributed fairly and equitable among their citizens. I'm also speaking of rich and developed countries that must make sure that the commitments that they make are more than short-term displays for public relations purposes. Within an intricate juggling of meetings and negotiations where unconditional support to peace and sustainable development is declared in the morning, and $1 billion weapons sales deals are made in the afternoon, nothing is impossible as long as the promotion of democracy and human rights replace the rhetoric exposed by the great powers, those proud pioneers of freedom and democracy, with pragmatic actions towards peace and the protection of collective interest, instead of the interests of a mighty few, who pretend because it is to their benefit or to their business profits to be oblivious to the true causes of inequalities and injustice throughout the world. In a very recent conference in Perth, the chairman of BHP started to talk about looking at the local contents, appealing, making appeal to the multinationals not to only suck money, but to look at the living conditions of the poor in the countries that they go. Thus, I say that there will not be sustainable development for all unless we all make a sustainable change in the way we engage with fragile and conflict-affected states. In order to do this, we must start by putting human dignity above any other political, economic, or strategic interest or consideration. We also must not impose patronizing values and presumptions as if seeking to civilize countries. In other words, we must replace an engagement model that is corrupted by interest with a true model of justice that promotes inclusive and sustainable development for all. If we want justice for all, we must free all peoples living in conflict. These countries did not achieve even a single millennium development goal. They face insurmountable obstacles when trying to escape from a situation of fragility without the effective support of the international community. International assistance is essential to the sustainability of these nations. However, the approach adopted by development partners must be suitable to the real needs of these countries, and the engagement must be restricted to the specific circumstances and challenges of each nation. On the other hand, one cannot make the mistake of trying to solve the problems of these people, much less trying to impose solutions without their direct involvement. The experience in transitioning from conflict into stability in Timor-Leste through the UN transitional administration taught us that the only path, even if it is a painful one, is to search for the root causes of our problems within our societies. If we are part of the problem, we must necessarily be an even bigger part of the solution. Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, the G7 plus member countries are united by a common cause of peace building and state building, sharing their experiences with each other. We are monitoring closely the challenges faced by countries such as the Central African Republic, South Sudan, and Guinea-Bissau, and we want to promote a culture of solidarity under the banner of fragile-to-fragile cooperation. As a group, we congratulate the UN Secretary-General for launching the agenda on sustaining peace and pledge our all support to the promotion of this important initiative. Although the G7 Plus is overall a relatively small group and weak countries, poor people, each of its members has direct experience in handling conflicts and violence. Unfortunately, some of these countries continue to live in the same troubled situations of conflict and violence, which is why we must have direct participation and added responsibility in contributing to build and maintain peace in each of these countries. Being home to around 400 million people, most of us have become a playground for regional and global politics, an experimental lab for peacekeeping, humanitarian aid, and development approaches, and a breeding ground for multi-billion dollar corporations seeking to exploit our resources. Some of us have been taking steps to escape the trap of permanent instability and conflict by making use of national mechanisms with wisdom and courage. We believe that our experience enables us to contribute so that the community of nations may achieve sustainable and lasting peace. This requires national leadership and ownership of decisions, programs, and mechanisms, supported by flexible and efficient international intervention. Our commitment to promoting the G7 Plus is also based on our strong desire to share experiences, strengthen fragile-to-fragile cooperation, implement the SDGs and naturally strive to live up to the motto, leave no one behind and reach the furthest behind first. It is firmly agreed by the G7 Plus that consolidating the sector of justice is of paramount importance for peace building and state building. It is also vital for conveying trust and attracting the necessary investment for developing the economy. We face several common challenges that include legal frameworks that are weak or inadequate to our realities, poor and limited infrastructure, and of course difficulties in capacity building and training of human resources. These are vital requirements for enabling access to justice for all. The justice sector is unequivocally a key sector for development. A fragile sector of justice may jeopardize the very state as well as the economic and social development of the nation. No one will invest in the economy if there is not a legal system ensuring that the law is upheld. And without investment, there is no employment. And without employment, there is no peace. This requires both sound cooperation with our development partners and a careful and inclusive internal process that involves not only government and public agencies, but also civil society and the community. Consequently, SDG 17, seeking to strengthen the means of implementation and to breathe new life into global partnership for sustainable development, splits up into several important goals that are valid instruments for the transformation we seek to achieve. In order to be successful, we must maintain a critical view of the process and make monitoring a key part to ensure we remain on the right track. In short, we want to see an actual impact on the lives of the people instead of merely statistical results. Consequently, we must at all times place people at the center of our actions. This is as valid for the partner that receives assistance as it is for the partner that provides it, humanizing partnership. is a vital precondition for everyone's success. Development partners on the ground must step out from their comfort zone. One cannot have their homework already prepared by copying what was done in other countries over the years. We need more creativity, more sensitivity to the specific intricacies of each mission, more consultation, and even more evidence-based decision-making, so that we may identify constraints and propose partnership solutions. Last but not least, we need time, sustainable reforms, good practices, and strong institutions cannot be built in a day. Thank you very much for your patience.